You ever find yourself flicking through an encyclopedia and coming across one particular item that's interesting? Following that through, turning over the page, I find something that's even more interesting. Following that through, and that's the kind of thing that we're doing here today. There's Ian, Rachel, Melanie, Richard, and I'm Marcus. The programme's called Follow That.
Obviously, as this is just a pilot, we won't be having, we haven't got the whole, the proper set here. But this is an approximation, a model, and you can see what it's like. Bright colours and fairly informal so that people can move in and out, fairly fluid, I think. And all around us, there can be lots of interesting objects, books, that sort of thing, and generally a fairly light and easygoing approach to the subject matter.
There will, of course, be a title sequence in the series featuring this attractive little chappie here, who will be animated, he'll revolve, and there'll be various graphic images put over the top of him. There'll also, of course, be music, which will sound something like this.
An earring as opposed to like a stud, because it's actually a ring that goes right the way through. Mm. Yeah?
Yeah, but they all go right the way through.
It's just more technically an earring rather than an ear stud.
Of course, it's an earring, but it stays in my ear. It's a little butterfly clip at the back.
Oh, that's fiendishly clever.
It is, actually. What isn't so fiendishly clever is that every time you buy an earring, because I've only got the one hole in one of my ears, I have to buy two. I don't think that's fair at all.
Have another hole.
Give you the one to me.
Do you know why it is that you always see sailors wearing an earring in one ear?
I didn't know you always did see sailors.
Well, no, all right, you don't. But, you know, in films, people like Errol Flynn, you always see them. Well, the reason, it's all to do with Greek burial customs, ancient Greek burial customs.
No.
Yes? Yes, it is. Because the ancient Greeks believed that when you died, you had to get across a river called the River Styx in order to get to the underworld, or Hades, the land of the dead. And to get across, you had to pay this boatman called Charon, or Charon, and he'd ferry you across. And if you didn't have the cash on you, you'd get left across the other side of the river for eternity. Huh. So when they buried you, they'd put a coin in your mouth, sort of under your tongue, so that you'd have it on you to pay him. And sailors, of course, they might die far from home with no relatives to give them the money, or they might be drowned and not have their bodies recovered. So they'd carry their payment in the form of a piece of gold in their ear, which was an earring.
Insurance policy, yeah?
So people like myself and Marcus, who've got the cheap, the tin and the plastic earrings, best not die at sea.
You just wouldn't know.
Oh, stuck on the sticks, you know.
You know, there's another tradition about sailors and earrings. If you've got a pair of earrings and the sailor has got one and he gives the other one to his sweetheart, that means that however far he travels over the seven seas, they'll always meet up again. Because sailors are really superstitious. Yeah. And they like lucky charms and things like that. That's what tattoos are. Oh, yes, they are. Every single one of them. Tattoos are lucky charms, like roses and flowers and hearts and things, to ward off evil spirits. And that's a tradition that all sailors are sort of carried around the world.
Oh, right. Speaking of the things all around the world, did you know that rats exist in every single country in this world?
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
Tap it up and see what we've got on the old computer here for rats.
On the top. What country?
Yep. Little guy.
Into the food.
Sneaking along the pantry here, along he goes.
How about cream cracker?
Into the cracker.
Here's cream
cracker. Right, there you go. Actually, the rats were responsible for bringing the Black Death, the plague, into this country. Yeah. They brought it over from China on boats. They came back on the boats that came back from China.
They came with the merchants.
With the merchants, yeah. China had it in about 1333, I think it was, and it came over to England in 1348. Is that right?
That's right, yeah. And within a year, a third of the population were dead.
Just like that.
Do you know why it was called the Black Death?
No.
Because the symptoms were rather nasty. When your glands would swell up to the size of grapefruits, and then they'd turn black and fester during the 4 or 5 days it took you to die.
You know the nursery rhyme, ring a ring of roses?
Pocket full of posies.
Tissue, all fall down. Right, well, that is thought to be a commemorative rhyme of the Black Death, the plague, because ring-a-ring of roses, one of the first symptoms was a ring of sort of rosy pink spots.
Before the grapefruit stage.
Pocket full of posies, people carried herbs. Are you listening?
Yes.
People carried herbs in their pockets to ward off diseases. Tissue, that's another symptom of the plague.
Yes,
sneezing. Right. And all fall down. Speaks for itself.
Boom, they're all dead.
Altogether nasty creatures, rats. But it was the actual fleas that carried the bubonic plague. Mm. They jumped off the rats, the fleas fled, and then they bit you and caused the plague. But, well, did you see the the Indiana Jones film, you know, the new one, yeah. Last Crusade. Right? Well, in that, there's a scene there where they're in the sewer and they needed, well, the film crew needed to get 8,000 rats. Of course, you couldn't go around to your average sewer and pick up a couple of...
Or Tesco's.
Excuse me.
Yes. Do you have any sewer rats for sale? Well, anyway, they had to get them from laboratories because, of course, they'd be disease-free, because you couldn't have Harrison Ford knee-deep sewer rats.
But they'd be white rats.
Well, yeah, so they had to spray them and colour them and then to teach them to swim, because being in a laboratory, they hadn't learnt to swim. Not at all. Follow that.
Yeah, well, you can follow that, because you know there are like lots and lots of rats in this country here. And you know, you might think that they're indigenous, but as I said, they were brought over from China, not actually deliberately, but they did come over on the boats. Yeah. There are a lot of things about us, around about us, plants, animals, that we might think of as being very English somehow, which aren't. Stinging nettles are one example. Stinging nettles did not grow in this country until the Romans invaded it and brought the nettles with them. And they brought them deliberately.
Cheers, Hadrian.
Well, you blame them, yeah. And they brought them because they hated the cold over here, you know, much colder than Italy. And they used to get out there and rub each other, or they used to probably rub themselves, I guess, but with nettles to keep warm. They've got the fiery feeling,
Never had a cold. You can have something off your nose despite your face. I mean, sting
it
yourself.
Never heard of
St. Bernard with a big barrel full of brandy.
That was the Swiss brought it.
Didn't happen. Another thing they brought over was rabbits. Before the Romans came, we only had hares in Great Britain. They brought the rabbits to feed the troops, because rabbits breed very quickly, so you get a lot of meat.
Like rats?
Very quickly, like rats.
Female rats can have 120 babies.
The rabbits burrowed out, escaped, carried on breeding like mad, and now we've got masses of rabbits and very few hares.
That's right.
Quite sad, really.
Well, I think you've got to actually be able to catch them. You know, the Romans would have to catch them. And the interesting thing about catching rabbits is you can actually do it. Well, do it single-handedly, without traps and things, because one of the things about our vision is that we've got eyes on the front of our head, like Mr. Phrenology here, you know, and we have stereo vision. With two eyes, you can judge distances. Right. Now, rabbits have got eyes on the side of the head, you know, one here and one here, and they can't judge distances because they're looking that way for the predators that side.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And on the other side, so they can't tell how far the predator is away. So, for example, if Mr. Phrenology is going to be the rabbit, all right? Yeah, give him some ears.
There we go.
All right, you got it? Now then, I'm going to pretend to be a Roman centurion.
Right. Good, I like it. Yeah, nice.
Wanting to, have some tea, and I'm going to catch this particular rabbit. So I'm going to walk towards it. Getting smaller.
Speaking Latin as you go.
I'm smaller.
I'm
quieter. And this rabbit thinks you're all the way over there.
The rabbit still thinks I'm just saying distance away. There you go, eh?
That's brilliant.
So what you're saying is that you just
never moved,
you see. Really?
And that's, you look a bit daft wandering round fields.
There's a lot of you.
being a vegetarian, of course, I find that very distasteful. But I tell you, you can actually prove this thing about stereo vision. It's very, very hard for people to see how far away something is using only one eye. So if everyone just place this in front of you, if you cover up, better watch the chair there. I haven't got very good distance vision. Cover up one of your eyes, like this, and then try putting your finger in from the side to locate where the bottle is. And I'm not faking it, 9 times out of 10, you will completely miss.
That's weird.
That's because you need information from both eyes coming in to give you the kind of stereo vision.
Oh,
we've got brilliant stereo vision because we evolved from creatures which swung about in trees. A fundamentally important thing about swinging about in trees is to know where the next branch is coming from. Because otherwise, if you miss, then it's hurtling down to a kind of crumpled mess on the floor.
No more swinging.
Or if you don't see one, it can smack you in the face.
Exactly. Yeah. So we found it more important to have eyes in the front of our head, to have stereo vision, than to have eyes on the side to see predators. Or there's all sorts of other things that we could have gone for, which is like having big eyes like ours to see in the dark, but we just didn't think it was that important.
Is it true, this thing about carrots? If you eat lots of carrots, then you can see better in the dark. Is that actually true?
Well, no. I mean, there's a substance in the eye called carotene.
In the eye.
The other name for it is vitamin A, which is important in seeing in low light, like seeing in the dark. Mm. So, yes, it's true in that respect, but no, it's not true, because most people have got enough vitamin A in their diet without having to eat any more carrots to supplement that.
There's a lot of vitamin A in carrots, though.
There's a lot of vitamin A in carrots, a lot of vitamin A in oranges, and about the only difference it'll make to your life if you start eating lots of carrots is that your skin will start to turn yellow because of all the keratin.
Can you drink that juice?
Did you know how that story about carrots making you be able to see in the dark started?
No.
In the Second World War, the Nazis were getting very worried and very curious about how the British pilots seemed to be able to see and therefore bomb difficult targets in the dark with no moon, no lights.
And the blackout.
And the blackout.
Now, the Ministry of Information put out the story that they were eating a lot of carrots, the pilots, so they could see in the dark. Now, this was great news for everyone because carrots weren't rationed like meat was, or cheese, or sweets.
Right.
You could grow them in your back garden. There was carrot jam, toffee carrots.
They don't actually grow on trees.
Carrot cake.
Exactly.
So they were trying to encourage people to grow more carrots.
Propaganda. Dig for victory.
All right.
But what was really making the pilots be able to see the targets was radar.
Good old radar.
Do you know how radar works? Do you know how radar works?
Hang
on to that. And that. Now, you're going to do some juggling in a minute.
Yeah.
All right. Now then, those aren't two oranges and an apple. The green one now has become... Of course not. The green one now has become a radio wave.
Ah.
And you are now...
In this case,
an aeroplane.
I'm going to be a fighter aircraft, and Marcus is going to be my enemy fighter aircraft. Give me some enemy fighter aircraft.
Well, I'm just the target here.
The target, fair enough. Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to see how long it takes for my radio wave, which is this thing, to go to Marcus and come all the way back. Right. So, Melanie, if you could count the time it takes for this apple to go from me to Marcus and then come back. Here we go. Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Five?
We'll take five, though, because you started a bit late, didn't you?
Sorry.
Now, let's assume that Marcus goes further away.
The enemy
aircraft
suspected that he is under reconnaissance.
Right, is now scanning.
Will retreat.
So Marcus thinks that I've got no idea where he is.
Uh-huh.
OK, Melanie, you're paying attention, because I'll start counting on time this time.
Okay.
So I send out my radio beam. Here we go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Right. To 9. I now know that my enemy aircraft is miles away. So I have to use my miles away missile to blow him out of the sky. Simple as that.
Exactly.
That's how radar actually works.
The other thing about radar, what it means is it means radio detection and ranging.
Uh-huh.
It's an acronym because the word radar is made up from the initial letters of the words it describes.
All parts of those words.
All parts of those.
So like ray, it's
radio and detection and ranging.
Yeah, there's loads of that, like laser. Laser's that thing they're always talking about in the science fiction films and Doctor Who and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
What it actually means is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation.
Correct.
No,
that's a bit of a mouthful of that.
This is a very good one. Posh, which means port out starboard home. Because in the olden times, if you were going by sailing ship over to the east, to India, for instance, you had a lot of money and you could afford a nice cabin on the shady side of the ship. You went port out and starboard home.
Yeah.
A lot of money. You want a posh person.
It doesn't mean port out shady side.
It doesn't. Follow that.
I guess
actually, Rachel's a bit posh, isn't she?
She is.
She's worse than anyone.
No, there is. There's another one. Smog, which means
smog.
Yes, it means smoke laden fog. And that's the stuff that you got in the 19th century in London.
Still get in Los Angeles even today.
Yeah pollution, lovely. nasty
Pom's another one, actually. The Australians, you know, they call us
whinging
Poms.
Pom?
Whinging Pommy, that's right. Well, that comes from, you know, actually when we were going over there, travelling over there, it's people on migration.
Nothing to do with apples?
Nothing to do with apples at all. No, no Frenchmen over there.
There's a more modern one, which is yuppie.
Mm-hmm.
It's a YUP, young urban professional. It's the modern equivalent of posh, basically.
Not dissimilar to yourself, Ian.
I take great offence on that.
You know, my favourite one is, in fact, apart from radar, is scuba. You know, scuba diving.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because scuba, S-C-U-B-A, stands for self-contained underwater breathing apparatus.
That's a neat one.
I like that one. There's no cheaty bits in that one.
Yeah,
it's a real one.
I didn't know it was an acronym. Right.
Well, it's acronym, and also what you need is an aqualung.
If you're scuba diving.
Exactly. So hang on a minute. I'll show you how a frog dives.
He's very good, isn't he?
Yeah, he's
lovely.
There's a balloon. Hang on to that.
Okay.
Right, I'm going to cut this
steady
balloon.
Steady on.
The balloon.
Yeah.
Now, you see, when the air, the oxygen, comes up from the cylinders, in the tube, into the mask, where do the bubbles go?
Into the mask? Does it go into the mask?
The air goes into the mask, breathe the air in the nose, the bubbles have got to go out.
Right.
So what you've got to do is you need a non-return valve to allow air out, but no water in.
So a one-way valve?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Sounds
good. This is an Enid Blyton story, isn't it?
What do you think of that?
Marcus, I think you've told us this story just as an excuse to make that funny noise, haven't you?
I like that noise. The thing is, you see, there's no water going to get into the mask, and therefore you can see, and the bubbles go to the surface.
I'll tell you what, a big problem about, if I may borrow this bottle which you've been looking at, a big problem about diving is if you stay down for too long and then come up quickly, you can end up getting this thing which they call the bends, which has killed an awful lot of divers. What it is if you spend a lot of time at quite a deep depth, say about 60 metres, you're under a lot of pressure because of this weight of water bearing down upon you.
Right.
Under that kind of pressure, your blood can hold more gas in it than it can at the surface. Mm-hmm. So if you come up to the surface quickly, what happens is the gas comes out of your blood really quickly. Very much like if you imagine the water in this bottle is your blood, and it, because it's under pressure, because the lid's on, then all the gas stays in there. But if the pressure is released really quickly, you get this kind of effect where bubbles are forming all the way inside the water.
That's good.
Now, that's great if you've got a nice soft drink like lemonade or a kind of Perrier or whatever. But if it happens in your blood, then it can be disastrous. It's a bit like having an airlock in your central heating system. The hot water can't get to the bedroom because the radiator can't get, and the radiator doesn't get hot, all that kind of thing. If it happens in your blood, you get an air
big
bubble which
trouble.
Stops it getting into your brain. You could die very quickly.
Trouble.
Nasty way to go.
So
how do they deal with it then?
The way they deal with it is that they either come up to the surface very slowly and let the air come back into the lungs at a nice pace, or they have to go into a decompression chamber, which means they come up very quickly, and then they say you've been down for about an hour, you have to spend about 5.5 hours in a decompression chamber to overcome it. You can see this kind of effect of the gas dissolving here, which is like the thing they do at the end of Formula One racing things when somebody's won. They get an awfully bottle of champagne and you get this kind of thing. Which is an awful waste of champagne, I'll admit, but it is a little bit of fun, isn't it?
Did you actually know that the deepest
you can go down underwater while you're holding your breath without getting the bends, if you come up in one go, it's 35 feet. Anything further down than 35 feet? Yeah, that's right.
Because like diving boards, you go into sort of 18 feet of water, don't you?
Exactly. So it just shows you can't go down too far. And actually, you know, before they had Aqualung and any equipment for diving underwater, people still did go down and stay down for quite long periods of time. Pearl divers used to train their lungs to expand, right?
Yeah.
You know, so slowly, like opera singers, I guess, to train their lungs. And guess how long they could stay underwater? At quite, you know, great depths.
Well, I can hold my breath for about a minute.
A minute and a half.
These guys could stay under there for about 3.5 to 5 minutes.
Yeah.
They could stay down so far because they used to block up their nose and their ears with sort of any grease, like pink fat or whatever.
Because if you're in a swimming pool, your ears start to hurt if you go down.
That's right. You know that feeling when you go down too far.
You know the other thing about pearls is that they are very important as symbols of virginity, believe it or not, because if you look at any portraits of Queen Elizabeth I, if you look at any portraits of Queen Elizabeth I, she's wearing pearls in all of them. So you can see this one.
Where?
Well, where do you want them? She's got some there, she's got some there, there's plenty of pearls.
Shells everywhere.
Yeah, this was a symbol that she was the virgin queen, you know, she never married, and there are all these images of her purity and chastity. And the Elizabethans would know what all this meant, because they're very used to looking at pictures in this way. They didn't look at them as realistic things, they're more like sort of cartoons or adverts or something like that. So this one's called the Armada portrait.
It's not a very funny cartoon, is it?
No, well, it doesn't have to be a funny cartoon.
For Bessie, isn't it?
No, I don't get the joke at all.
Well, all right, it's more like an advert then in that case. So there's the advert that says she rules the world because she's holding a globe.
Oh, yeah.
There's the English ships going out to meet the Spanish Armada coming in from there.
Sunny day there.
There's, on a much nastier day, in fact night, there's the Spanish Armada crashing on the rocks in Scotland. There's lots of other ones of these symbols.
It's quite
hang on,
mean,
this, this one's called the rainbow portrait, and the reason it's called that is she's holding a rainbow, although it looks more like a sort of glass
banana.
Tube. No, more like a glass tube. But
bicycle wheel.
And that's a symbol for peace because it means that she brings the sunshine after the storms.
Mm.
And also on her dress, she's got little eyes and little ears, if you can see them.
Oh, yes.
And what that means is that she sees and hears everything. So it's a bit sinister, really. Except that bit there. Well, it might be a fold in the dress, but some people think it's a mouth.
And so if you come too close, she'll bite your head.
No, it's not quite that, no. What that would mean is that she's very famous because she's spoken about and heard and seen by everyone.
But why does she look the same in all these portraits?
Well, her face looks the same in all of them. The reason for that is that
the
painters.
Same person, yeah?
Yeah, well,
she's facing
but it's
the same
actually
way,
it's the same position and the same expression. The reason for that is that they had.
Sorry, there's water everywhere. We've kind of covered dead Greeks, dead sailors. We've had rats, death by bubonic plague, how to kill a rabbit, death by falling out of a tree, death by coming up from deep waters far too quickly. Quite honestly, I found the bit about Elizabeth I dead good, really. Yeah, absolutely.
Follow that.
I don't think I possibly can. Where did you get your earring from, anyway?
I got it from a place near Woolworths.